Welcome to Oath Keepers Now. I'm Mike Chisholm. I'm your host for today's show. Oath Keepers is a nonpartisan organization. Oath Keepers consists of active duty and retired military, law enforcement, firemen, EMTs, anyone who's sworn the oath to the U.S. Constitution. Today with me, I have our Bannock County VSO for the veterans, Melissa Hartman. Thank you for showing up.
You're welcome. Thank you.
I know a lot of people have heard of you and know of you. I was wondering if you could tell our audience out there a little bit about yourself and what you do.
Well, my name is Melissa Hartman. I am married to a Marine and Army veteran.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, very proud of him. We have together 6 children and 4 grandchildren. I've worked in veteran services for about 12 years. I've worked for Bannock County for the last 6.
Okay, and when are you located at the vets?
We recently
the veterans
moved.
Clinic? Where are you located?
We recently moved into ISU now. Bannock County and Idaho State University partnered in July of 2011, and that partnership grew my office by the students at ISU, but it also enabled me to have a lot of administrative support staff that I didn't have when I worked based in the county office.
You have a lot of interaction with the students, don't you?
I do.
And isn't that good? I mean, that's a really good avenue. I mean, it's a really good avenue because we need to get our young people understanding the importance of course, defending our Constitution, but how the many soldiers and what they go through. And I'm babbling again, as usual, you know, from Hawaii. But and let me check my notes here. I have a lot of questions for you today.
Okay.
Let's see. Blah, blah, blah. What programs do you actually offer the veterans? And let me ask you, when I say that, especially the returning veterans, what programs do you offer them?
Well, there's a lot of education benefits that are available to veterans, several different types. The most prominent that everybody's hearing about right now is the post 9/11 GI Bill. That is a benefit that pays the tuition. So it's a little different for every school. So let's just take ISU for example. It is a benefit that will pay their tuition, $1,000 a year towards their cost of their books, and it also pays the equivalent of a BAH for an E5. And that averages about $900 to $1,000 in our area.
For those that don't know what a BAH is, could you tell us the acronym?
Basic Allowance for Housing.
Okay. Boy, there's a lot of acronyms. That's one thing about being in the military.
You learned ABC pretty quick.
With a lot of the returning soldiers, we've heard of PTSD. What specific programs does the Bannock County Veterans VSO you offer?
Mm-hmm. Well, PTSD or post-traumatic stress disorder is a mental health issue that
affects
a lot of our veterans.
Well, when you say mental health, a lot of people will start saying, "Oh my gosh, something's wrong." But you know, that's a very bad way of looking at it because we all have our own issues. But tell me a little more about it.
There used to be a lot of stigma around saying, "Oh, I have a mental illness." Now I am a firm believer denying that or saying that isn't what you have, that doesn't help. And mental illness is no different than a cancer. It's no less debilitating and it can be no less of an emergency and a life-threatening emergency. More of our soldiers are committing suicide than are dying from an illness.
Wow, I didn't know that.
So mental illness is very serious. It's a huge emergency. We're lucky in Pocatello. We're lucky in southeastern Idaho. We have a couple of resources specifically for veterans. We have the clinic, the CBOC.
Where's that at?
It's on Hospital Way, so 444 Hospital Way.
444, guys.
It is a wonderful facility, and our clinic here in Pocatello has a really great staff. They'll see veterans. We can do a simple enrollment. My office can help the veteran enroll, and you can enroll at any stage. I enroll World War II veterans, Vietnam veterans, Korean veterans, Desert Storm, Desert Shield veterans.
You know, you brought up, I may be shifting gears here a little, but you know I shift gears all the time in my show here, and it's my show, so I can do it. But you mentioned Vietnam veterans, you mentioned World War II, Korean veterans.
Sure.
Now, some I've had the impression that it seems that some benefits that the veterans are receiving today, post 9/11, seem to be a little more, if not greater, than that of those that the Vietnam vets had. So can you kind of help explain why they get a better vet benefits than those that served in Vietnam? Oh, for example, of course.
The VA is getting better. The answer is the VA knows that the benefits they offered to veterans who served in Vietnam, or benefits were slow coming for veterans who are exposed to Agent Orange. The VA knows what they did was wrong, and they're trying to fix that. They can't fix the past.
Yes.
The way Vietnam veterans were treated and the behaviors that happened and the benefits that were administered and the fashion that they were administered and the speed that it, the length of time, not the speed, the length of time that it took for those benefits to be administered, the VA is trying to fix that, so our OEF and OIF veterans.
Another acronym.
Operation Iraqi Freedom, Operation Enduring Freedom. Okay. So our veterans who served in Iraq and Afghanistan, they don't have to experience the same trials that happened and occurred for Vietnam veterans. They're very quick. The VA is rectifying that. So you'll hear a lot of differences between, and it really is how you look at it. Yes. Veterans who served in Iraq and Afghanistan appear to be getting better benefits than veterans who served in Vietnam. But that's really not the case. The difference is that it's becoming more of an issue. Vietnam veterans, are you kidding? They would say, I don't have a mental illness. I'm going to steer clear of that because that just makes me sound like I'm crazy.
Well, when you talk about PTSD and this concerns me because I'm using this as an example. The Second Amendment, the right to keep and bear arms. Mm-hmm. From what I understand, if you get tagged with PTSD, you lose your CCW, which I know that one, concealed weapons permit pretty much.
Glad you asked that question.
Yeah, can you help explaining that?
That's not the case. There is a law called the Brady Handbill.
An unconstitutional law, in my opinion.
Okay.
Thank you. But
because of that law,
okay,
when a veteran is deemed unable to handle his financial affairs, the Brady Hand Bill comes into effect, and that veteran at that point can no longer purchase or own a gun, a weapon. There are some waivers now that they can apply to have that amended from
right.
their incompetency. But just because you have a diagnosis of PTSD and just because you're getting a service-connected compensation payment for PTSD doesn't mean that you're not able to own a weapon.
Well, I believe a lot of our a lot of our viewers out there will be really glad that you said that because, you know, we all believe in all of our rights, our Bill mm-hmm. of Rights. And recently we had the National Defense Authorization Act, mm-hmm. but we won't go there on that, which raised a lot of concerns. You spoke of Agent Orange.
Yeah.
What about mesothelioma?
Mesothelioma is a cancer that is very specific lung cancer. And the source of it is asbestosis, or asbestos, and then it causes asbestosis, which is mesothelioma. So asbestos is the insulation that was wrapped around pipes and wires in ships.
So a lot of the Navy veterans.
Navy veterans have a high exposure to asbestos, leading to asbestosis and mesothelioma. Those are claims that a veteran can file for service connection. But remember, the VA is very specific, and there are four characteristics of a well-grounded claim for service connection.
Can you break that down for us?
I can.
Sure.
Number one, a veteran has to have a firm diagnosis of a condition that's disabling today.
Such as mesothelioma.
Mesothelioma, okay. Post-traumatic stress disorder, diabetes. Okay.
Well, even diabetes now.
Sure.
Okay.
Well, for Agent Orange, yes.
For diabetes. Agent, okay.
Okay, so firm diagnosis. Number two, they have a verifiable event while they're on active duty. Number three.
That means something have to actually, we have to have, you would have to have had documented, I'm sorry, there's the camera. This is why it's.
Documented conditions. So for mesothelioma, so our veteran who has lung cancer, has mesothelioma, asbestosis, he has to prove that he served on board a ship.
So if it was like in, and I have a friend, a retired chief petty officer, and he retired many years ago, and he served in the gun turrets. I'm not really sure what they have on ships. I was in the Army. So, but I believe he has mesothelioma now, and he says he's just having all kind of problems, just trying to get, like what you said, just to get to a VSO to get it done. But he's in another state. He's not in Idaho.
Oh, that's why. See, now Idaho, we're like ranked top five in our regional office. So we're pretty fortunate. I'm going to brag it up a little bit.
There's nothing wrong when we're good.
Our Boise regional office is fabulous. They really are. They're a great group of people. Really care about our veterans. Most of them are veterans. 92% or something like that are veterans out of the Boise Regional Office.
Veterans helping veterans.
Absolutely.
Yeah, we were talking about PTSD earlier, and I want to read, I was watching a movie the other night, and in the beginning of the movie, they had this phrase, and I wrote it down a second ago, so if I mess it up, I apologize, but I think it's very relevant to our conversation on PTSD. And if I can find it on my notes here, sorry, give me one second here. Let's see, where is it? And it goes like this. Wars are started long before the first shot is fired and lasts long after the last shot is heard. Wouldn't you consider that part of a PTSD? Or
very profound statement. Very profound statement. And yes, that is part of PTSD. You know, when somebody experiences combat, it changes who they are.
Immediately.
It's a life. It's no different than a woman giving birth to a child.
I wouldn't know.
It isn't.
But I've been there for both my children's birthdays.
It isn't any different. You know, it changes who that person is. And nothing's going to take that back. But because the VA is recognizing the importance of serving our veterans, they're able to get help, and there are more services available for post-traumatic stress disorder. And we talk about it, and it isn't taboo, and it isn't a horrible thing. It's okay to talk about it. And if you have post-traumatic stress disorder, it's okay. You can learn a coping skill, and the VA has services to be able to help you with that. It's not a stigma. It's not a bad thing.
It's been a stigma for so long that. And that's good to hear it coming from you, and you're the Bannock County VSO, which is really good. But sometimes it's really hard to change one's, you know, perception of a certain, you know, quote unquote, being politically correct. Maybe that's a little off base, but, you know, for many, many years, someone would say PTSD, they'd immediately hang the chain of. I don't even know how to say it politically correct, and I don't mean, I don't.
People
really
would be like, he's a little crazy. You know, that's not the case.
Well,
it's not the case, but we need to be a little more tolerant. And there are times when we have veterans who have post-traumatic stress disorder, and maybe they're a little standoffish. Maybe they're a little more quiet. Maybe they're a little less willing to walk up to you and say, hey, how you doing? But it doesn't mean they don't mean those things.
And I know we're focusing a lot on PTSD, which is very good.
It's a big issue.
It is a big issue. And I hope I can get through all my questions, but I'm sure I can. I got a few more minutes left.
Okay.
Time goes by fast when you talk. But is there any, let's move from PTSD to this.
Okay.
I heard you, we were speaking earlier before we began the shooting of this, but you have service connected and non-service connected. Could you define? I mean, of course we know what service connected and non-service is, but what are the prerequisites and what's the procedures for that?
Sure. The answer to that is the federal law is very complex, and it's not as cut and dry as just. These are the things that have to happen, but I can give you very basics. the best thing to do if somebody thinks that they have a claim or that they need to file for one of these two things is to contact a representative in their area. If it's in Bannock County, I'd be more than happy to help them. So first the service connected. Firm diagnosis of a condition that's disabling today, a verifiable event while they're in service, a history of the condition being chronic. And the last thing is the most important, it's a medical opinion connecting the first two things together. Okay.
And where does that medical opinion come from?
It can come from a lot of different sources, but it has to come from a PhD or higher. Okay. And it could be a private physician, it could be a VA physician. It will likely be a compensation and pension examiner for the Department of Veterans Affairs. But it can come from anybody.
You do an evaluation, pretty much, right?
Exactly. So then, that's the service-connected claim.
Okay.
So that's a directly a medical condition that's related to the person's active duty service. Then there's a pension, a non-service-connected pension. Non-service-connected pension is for wartime veterans. So anybody serving during a declaration of war.
Well,
which is very specific dates, and don't ask me because I don't know them right off the top of my head.
Neither do I, so I won't put you there.
But if a veteran is 65 or older, and their income and assets are below the level set by the law, which is $80,000 in assets, not counting their primary residence, and for a single veteran is just shy of $13,000 a year, so if their income is below that, or their medical expenses outweigh their income to make it below that, then they're eligible for this non-service connected pension. If they're younger than 65 years old and something has happened and they don't have an income anymore and they served during a period of war, what it consists of, you have to have 90 days of service on active duty with at least one of those days during a period of war. You don't have to go to theater or combat, but you have to have one day during a period of war.
That's what I want to ask you. Often I've been approached with about veterans and veterans benefits, mm-hmm. and I had been under the understanding, of course, I'm learning every day. We learn something new every
day. That's a good thing.
That you have to have 180 days of active duty service. And no, you're telling me 90 days.
90 days for non-service connected.
For non-service, okay. Now for service connected, would it be 180 or it doesn't? It's irrelevant, that's correct.
You can get hurt in boot camp.
You can get hurt, that's right. I just thought of that, see? I have to check my notes again.
You go right ahead.
Okay, here we go. And we passed that one. And we passed that one. My gosh, there's so many. There's so many things that we can talk about.
There are.
Let me ask you, the hospital that, and I didn't ask you this earlier,
that's okay.
And I don't like the people I have on my show. I always try to prep them before, just to tell them what I'm going to ask about, because I don't believe in blindsiding anyone, because I don't like to be blindsided. Who does? But we have the hospital that closed right there at ISU. From what I understand, we're trying to get the hospital as a veterans hospital. Is that in the works, or is that something that we just don't want to cross right now? I don't know. I should have had more notes. We should have talked.
You know what? It's a fabulous idea. Whether or not it's a possibility remains to be seen, but it is a fabulous idea.
Because you know, one thing I hear a lot about is veterans that are having to have procedures done. And I know we have our clinic here.
Mm-hmm.
And the clinic is super.
It is fabulous.
Our staff is super tremendous. Yes, it is.
They're working Saturdays.
That's how great they are.
That's how dedicated they are to veterans.
Yes.
I mean, you know, I'm not working Saturdays, trust me, but they are.
But that's true. That's dedication.
It is.
And what I hear is a lot of the veterans, especially the older ones, who's, you know, at times they have a very hard time. They have to drive all the way to Salt Lake City, or some of them, I guess, go to Boise. I guess it depends.
Not
in our area. Okay, then I was misinformed. But that's a 300-plus-mile round trip.
It's a 2.5-hour drive.
Not in traffic.
From Pocatello to the front door of the VA is a 2.5-hour drive, not counting traffic. And yes, it is a long drive. But the answer is most things can be done in Pocatello. Our clinic is no different than you going to your family doctor.
To your family doctor, right.
It's exactly
it's one of these immediate cares. Well, of course, not like the immediate cares. Our clinic is far better than that.
You know, it's...
And not knocking immediate care. I don't need a lawsuit on poor. Go ahead.
Our clinic is great. So if you are having your regular annual checkup and you're relatively healthy, the clinic is going to do everything you need. If you have the flu, the clinic is going to take care of you. If you have high blood pressure, the clinic is going to take care of you. If you have diabetes, the clinic is going to take care of you. Now, if you have a heart attack,
we go to Portneuf.
When you first have the heart attack, going to the emergency room.
Right.
But I mean, afterwards, you're going to need some aftercare.
Yes.
The VA needs you to go to a cardiologist, no different than what my doctor's Dr. Maynard. If I had a heart attack, I would go to the ER, and he would come and he would say, you need to go see a cardiologist. And he would say,
you're not going to have a heart attack. You have 6 kids. You're tough.
If I have a heart attack.
Just putting some humor here.
If I have a heart attack. When I have a heart attack, probably is more likely. So I'm not going to go to Dr. Maynard. He's going to send me to a cardiologist. Now, this is what happens with the VA. So, for example, one of our VA doctors is Dr. Curl, who's a great doctor, fabulous man, really cares about
his patients. I believe I've heard his name.
He's terrific. So, Dr. Curl, you go and you have a heart attack, and Dr. Curl says, hey, you know what? I can't take care of you. You need to see a cardiologist. Now, here's where the difference comes between the veteran and somebody who's not a veteran who goes to their primary care provider. When the VA sends you to a cardiologist, the cardiologist they're sending you to is in Salt Lake City. The cardiologist that Dr. Maynard's going to send me to is probably Dr. De La Rosa. That's the difference.
Okay, he's local.
He's local. Here
okay,
at
sorry, I've never heard of De La Rosa.
Another fine doctor. We're very lucky to have him. So what happens is the veteran will go to Salt Lake City. That cardiologist will do all the necessary initial workups and getting them on a treatment plan and getting things set up. And then they'll send them back to Dr. Curl, who has access because the VA has the best technology.
Yes, they do.
And so when Dr. Curl when you come back in to see Dr. Curl, he's going to go, oh, and here's what the cardiologist said. And it's all right there, right at the tip of his fingers. He's going to see it. He's going to know everything that happened. If you had an MRI, if you had a CT, a CAT scan.
A myelogram. I know that one.
Dr. Curl is going to know, and he's going to be able to read all the results of that instantly because it's all interconnected. The VA is totally connected to each other.
I should have told my audience out there a long time ago, and I apologize to the veterans, that the veterans have a new site up there called ebenefits.com, I believe.
.gov,
sorry. But once you get in there and you line, it's very secure.
It's extremely secure.
Yes. You get on there, you can see your blood work, you can see pretty much everything.
Mm-hmm. And if you get a premium account, you can email Dr. Curl.
Okay.
He's going to love me for promoting that.
And it's free.
It's free.
And it doesn't cost you $40 a year or $50 a month.
It's your benefit.
It is.
It's your benefit. As a veteran, this is what you signed on the dotted line for.
Well,
and it's okay for you to access those now.
When we all raised our hands, those that have, mm-hmm. and those that will, and those that want to in the future, you're signing a blank check for your life, for your country. And when we have great people such as yourself, I mean,
that
really takes the time to take care of people like the veterans. That's what it's all about, veterans helping veterans. And I don't know, I'll get a little emotional here,
now,
but I'll move on from that
point.
You
have to move forward because there's only one rule that I live by, and that's that nobody cries alone in my presence.
Oh, no, no.
So let's go on.
Well, yeah, we're down to just a couple of minutes. You have anything else you'd like to share that you think would be important and, well, relevant to? And we talked about PTSD, and it's not like I'm trying to sound repetitive, guys. Guys, they are. But the thing is, it really has been a stigma. So what has the VA been doing besides, you know, helping the patients? Mm-hmm. What have they been doing to educate the community that says, hey, just because you got PTSD, you know, has there been programs to educate the civilian populace? And I'm not degrading the civilian populace either, please.
The VA wants everybody to understand that veterans, although they have a unique set of disabilities, they've also have a unique set of experiences. And it's okay. We're gonna take care of what they need. But again, a veteran is just the same as you, just the same as me. You know,
We're
all human beings. The end of the day, we're all human beings. The VA's really using a lot of technology. You can Facebook every benefit there is in the VA. Each one of them have their own website.
Really? I don't know about Facebook.
Oh,
really?
Yeah. Go to Facebook. Find the VA. They're all over. You can get into Veteran Benefit Administration, the Veteran Health Administration, the Salt Lake City VA Medical Center.
But you can't get into eBenefits because that's a real secured site.
eBenefits is secure. You have to get on the VA.gov website. There's a quick link on the right-hand side, and you just click eBenefits, and you can access your health care benefits, and you can also access your claims benefits if you have a premium account.
Can you also, in eBenefits, like, put in a claim, let's say?
Working on that. You can do an e-file, and you can do it, yes.
Okay.
But when you do it that way, you're kind of on your own. So I would encourage everybody to come in and see me. I'm more than happy to take 45 minutes and visit with you. That's what it takes. And I fill that form out every day, 6-7 times sometimes. So come in. It's easy.
Remember that, guys. You need to come and see Melissa. You need to talk to her. We're down to, well, my engineer says 1 minute.
We've chatted.
Yes, we have.
It's nice.
And it's really nice to have someone such as yourself, as dedicated as yourself, to take care of our local veterans.
It's my honor.
Well, it's an honor to have you, and thank you for being on the show.
Thank you for inviting me.
Well, you're very welcome. And I basically always like to thank my guests, as I just did. But as always, God bless, good day, or good night, and for our republic. Pushing me around, boy.